Hello, it's the Anfield Wrap. It's the Anfield Wrap live from Tier 3. It's John Givens hosting, and I'm joined by Dan Morgan, by Gareth Roberts, and by Ian Ryan to talk about a few of the big stories coming out from football. I'm sure you'll have read all about them over the weekend. We were off this weekend, had a bit of sort of a long weekend, so you might have been maybe surprised not to see a bit more sort of reaction stuff or a bit more on Twitter. But we were giving ourselves some well-deserved time off when we can, and we weren't going to sack off our families just because billionaires were being knobheads. But we are ready to stick the boot into them now, or not. I'm not going to put words in these gentlemen's mouths. I'm just going to see what they think about a couple of things that have happened over the weekend. The first one is the £15 pay-per-view. So the idea of certain games this season being on pay-per-view TV to watch at £15 a go. We're also going to talk about Project Big Picture. So that news that came out on Sunday, I think it was, around lots of proposals put together, seemingly led by Liverpool and Manchester United. That is in, I would say, part three, actually, because we do have an insert. We've got Matt Parrish from the LFC Foundation giving us a little bit of an update on some stuff they've been working on at the foundation. But we'll start with pay-per-view. And I'm just going to ask the three gentlemen with me what they think. Just ask a bit of an open question about their instincts around it. And then I will go follow up with a few points if they're not sort of brought up. But I'll start with you, Dan. What was your sort of initial thoughts, and having had a few days to kind of sit on it, if you like, what are your thoughts now?
I think the initial thing for me that sort of comes to mind, and it still does, is that I really think that the Premier League is in trouble financially. I think this, compounded by the open letter that clubs put out around sort of, it was almost a plea to getting supporters back to stadiums, and sort of calling out the government in that, says to me that the Premier League are sort of not getting the sound bites they want from television companies in terms of revenue. And maybe they're sort of starting to be dictated to by said companies. Now, I think within that, you've got to sort of then look at how that changes. I didn't sort of expect it not to be a pay-per-view scenario, but what I didn't expect was something like £15 per game, which I think is, we can all agree, is scandalous on any front. So that is sort of the thing that jumped out to me. And the other thing that sort of does too is that, again, it's sort of that disassociation between how these corporations can sort of viably think they can sell this as a product. And if you take Liverpool, for example, you think about sort of away tickets being capped at £20. You think of an away supporter coming to Anfield for the first time. That's not an experience you can really bottle. That's not something that you can sort of package up and say, you know, this is something that we can give everyone, because it's not. It's literally 2,000-3,000 people at a time. Everyone knows the deal with watching the game on telly. Like, literally, it's what we all do in the majority of a sense. It's only a certain minority who's sort of lucky enough to go the game and experience, like I say, if you take Liverpool as an example, Liverpool under Klopp, this journey, this thing that then becomes more than a football game. It becomes this thing that you're involved in, invested in emotionally. You're on this sort of committed emotional ride with. To just then say, the thing you've been doing all your life, most years, i.e. watching games of football on the TV, we're now charging you £15 for, is, I don't see how they think it's going to become viable, other than it being a product that people need in terms of being used to watching the games, and therefore they might just swallow it. But I mean, the initial reaction seems to be quite the opposite, that people are saying, well, I'll just not bother, or you'll see things like illegal streaming pick up, or people just waiting for Match of the Day or whatever else.
Okay, Ian?
I think there's something around, and I agree with what Dan said there, there's something around maybe reading the room, and I don't think they've read the room at all. I mean, £15 is just, it feels wild. It really does. And I think, you know, in an ideal world, and maybe this is a little bit naive, you are hoping that it can continue in the same vein where everyone gets to see the games for free. But as Dan said, you know, clubs are probably coming under more and more pressure, where they felt they may have fans in the stadiums by October. I mean, don't get me started on that, by the way. You know, when you see some of the pictures floating around at the London Palladium, you think, fucking hell, hang on a sec. What's going on here? You know, don't tell me there's not some clever and smart people out there who can't get around the room and figure out our way to get fans back into stadiums, even if it's on a limited scale, which would do, you know, some clubs a massive favour. Maybe not necessarily the Premier League clubs if it was only low numbers. But I think, you know, in terms of the product itself, and there was a lot of noise last week, wasn't there, where people were saying, well, it's still the same product. It's not the same product. It's not even close. Mm. It's not even close to being the same product. And
well, just to dive in on that at point, Ian, sorry, the TV companies have admitted that themselves because they've asked for some money back.
Absolutely. And I think, you know, don't get me wrong, sometimes you can get lost in a football match where it still feels like it used to feel. And when Liverpool ended up winning the league last season, take that to one side for a minute. City played Chelsea and it's a brilliant game of football and it's bananas and you just kind of get involved in the game because it's such a mad game of football, regardless of what was on the line at the time. You could say similar about Leeds Man City a couple of weeks ago. It was brilliant. It was just end to end. It was, you know, all strategy was out the window. It was great to watch. But there's loads of games where it's not like that anymore because the fans play such a part. And I'm finding myself at times, as someone who watches nearly all the footy that's normally on, I'm either mentally switching off or literally switching off maybe towards the end of games where it's just, I'm losing interest a little bit. And Robbo and I did something with Steve Warnock last week, which I don't think is out yet. And it was, there was a little bit of chat off air, and I don't think Steve would mind me saying this because it's nothing, you know, nothing too revealing. But even he was saying he was speaking to maybe a dozen footballers over the last few months and they can't get up for it at times. It's really hard. And I don't think we can appreciate sometimes how hard it is for them. You can say, listen, they're getting paid loads of money. It's different. They live for the crowd. Gibbo, you're a performer, lad, aren't you? I mean, you know, you're not taking your top off with no one there, are you? You know what I mean? So they need that. And you can
not with the same flourish.
Absolutely. And it must be incredibly hard sometimes going into those environments. And we forget because sometimes we're watching it with the noise pumped through and you just kind of maybe have it in the background and you think, oh, it sounds like it used to a little bit. But it's not like that for them. I think to suddenly expect people to pay 15 quid is wild. And listen, there probably had to be a price at some point. It always felt inevitable, but it was never, or it never should have been £15.
Yeah. Gareth?
Yeah, I put a poll on the Anfield app, and we got some good numbers on it. So we got 16,819 people who took part in the vote, and the options were, the question was, are you prepared to pay the 15 quid to watch Liverpool v Sheffield United on Sky Sports box office? Yes, 5%. No, but I'd pay a lower fee, 21%. And no, I pay enough, 74%. So as Ian says, I think in terms of reading the room, well, they haven't done. I think, you know, what Dan's talking about as well around finances, I sort of get that. But when you dig into it, I don't think it's that appealing. I don't think it's worth the hassle almost of what it's caused because, you know, it's been reported that roughly 80% of the 14.95 would go on facilitating and servicing the scheme. The clubs would make around £3 per hit, if you like. And the projections are that it's basically going to make them £2 million. So, okay, £2 million in a pandemic, you know, is something maybe you don't want to turn down. But I think, you know, you've got to think about goodwill. You've got to think about the situation you're in. And you've got to think about that price point, surely. And, you know, when Netflix is £8.99, Spotify Premium's £9.99, Amazon Prime's £7.99, even Sky itself you can get for like £30 a month. To say for one match that you didn't even want before, that was off the table, that was a castaway, if you like, is now £15, just doesn't add up for me. And you know, I was looking at some of the arguments the other way, like, and seeing people saying, well, it's like the boxing. Well, okay, yeah. I mean, I can't speak for everyone in the room or everyone who's listening, but the way I've always worked the big boxing matches with my mates is, yeah, you're prepared to pay that because it's a big, massive boxing match between two big figures, one you really want to watch, not the castaway. But also, you get the boys round, you get the ale in, you get the pizzas, and you watch the boxing match. Yeah. You can't do that. You can't have people round at your house. Not in, you know, we're in the tears of the clown here. And we're not allowed to have anyone round at our house. So I think all of it doesn't add up. And also as well, we get told all the time that it's a global game now. And of course it is a global game. But that also means that you get to speak to people globally quite easily. And so when we start talking about it on social media, people chip in from America, from Canada, from wherever else around the world. And they're going, well, hang on. You can have a monthly subscription to Optus Sports and you get all Premier League, Champions League, Europa League, internationals for more than you're going to pay for one pay-per-view game. And then there's others as well. There's one in Canada, there's one in the USA. And all of this on top of that, you know, Dan's thing about the money again. Not picking on you, Dan, but...
No, I wasn't sticking up for it.
Liverpool are among the clubs that have contributed to there being £1 billion spent in the transfer window. So if you're coming with your cap out now saying, well, you know, we really need this, it just feels grim for me. It just feels grim, you know, when you've got people being told that, you know, you're going to be out of work because we're shutting bars and restaurants and whatever, and you're only going to get 2/3 of your wage. You know, this is supposed to be an escape. What happened to the idea that it boosts morale to have football available, that it's good for mental health and all that kind of stuff? Seems to have all gone out of the window for a cheap quid.
I'll stick with you, Gareth, for a second. Do you think a lot of this is down to, you know, comes down to a lack of goodwill between supporters and football clubs? And, you know, I've seen a few people, you know, you mentioned there, you know, you're looking at other people and what they're saying, and I've seen a few fans, you know, say to me or say, you know, on Twitter that I've seen that, well, I'm paying a tenner for the league for my EFL team, but I want to support them because they know that it's part of their community. And for a club like Wigan, you know, who we encourage people to pay a similar amount for when they played our under-23s, and so, you know, give them, you know, the club can do it. I think at that level there's a bit more kind of feeling of, well, I want to help and I want to throw my money in, and look, this game might not be worth a tenner, but I'll pay it because, you know, A, I get to watch it, and B, that the money's going there. Regardless of whether we think that these Premier League clubs need it or not, and like Dan says, they all arguably do, that goodwill's just not there, and that's years of supporters being treated badly, basically, that has led to this thing there where we're just like, fuck off, you're taking the piss.
Yeah, absolutely, mate. I think, you know, you're right there to say that it feels like for years and years and years, in every single way, you know, our loyalty to football clubs has been... But they've rinsed us, haven't they, basically? Yeah. I mean, you know, the fact that you're having so many kits come out, you know, I think that's grim, in that, you know, it's taking advantage of the fact that young kids will always want the newer kit, and then parents feel obliged to go out and get them. And, you know, we all know how it's worked in schools. If, you know, once upon a time, where if you wore the old one, you were a meth, and you know what I mean? And all of that's played upon, you know, same as the, you know, the prices of the tickets, they push them and push them and push them to see how far they can push you. And then eventually, obviously, in terms of Liverpool, we cracked and we walked out, which again went against the very sort of grain of being a football supporter. So it is that as well. It just feels like that step too far where you're like, hang on. And look, I hope that people do boycott it, people do protest against it, people do make it known how they feel about it. Because the other thing I'd say about it is, when supporters have made their feelings known and when they've come together as a collective, it's worked. You know, the price cap we already have on away tickets has come about because of the work of supporters. It didn't just come about by accident. You know, if they could get away with charging you 70 and 80 quid instead of 30, then they'd try and do that. So I think everyone's got to make the feelings known. And I think, to be honest, what I see in here, and certainly, you know, from people I know, etc., you know, that's obviously always flawed in terms of a survey, but I don't know many people who are prepared to pay 15 quid for Liverpool v Sheffield United. Most people are going to find a...
It's on Match of the Day about half an hour later.
Well, yeah. and you know, there are alternative methods, aren't there, let's be honest, you know, and that's another thing as well, that, you know...
Me goals on Sunday.
But, you know, the Premier League's trying to crack down on piracy and stuff over the years, and has gone to town on pubs and bars that have shown things illegally. But, you know, you can't then go, okay, 15 quid, because people will inevitably turn to any other method of watching it, especially during desperate times where they may not have 15 quid to spare to watch a game of football.
Robbo mentioned the point there about, you know, the the agent fees and that and the transfer spend. I mean, you know, it's a kick in the balls when you're seeing clubs go and spend that amount of money, then to all of a sudden say, listen, we need 2 million quid off you, which is what we're talking about here, but the figures that Robbo read out. And I think worth mentioning actually that Leicester were the only club I think who went against this as well. But I think it will also disadvantage certain clubs because it's the games that aren't scheduled for maybe BT or Sky anyway. So from a Liverpool perspective, we're probably on one of those channels most of the time anyway, aren't we, really? But if you're
I mean, for now, it depends on how it all goes.
They could switch that, I suppose. But if you're a West Brom or a Southampton, you could be copping for loads more than...
Do you think it's Southampton, clubs, based on last year, who were in, but they're almost paying the season ticket.
Absolutely. So all of a sudden, you know, if it's 15 quid every week, and don't get me wrong, someone will always pay this, and that's what they're relying on, aren't they? They're always relying on someone will pay for it because they want to watch the match. It'll be interesting to see whether, when it gets to the crunch, you know, what you've read out there in terms of the feedback and stuff, well, I wouldn't pay for it, Liverpool v Sheffield United. What are you doing when it gets to that time and it's cold and it's all a little bit shit at the minute? You think, yeah, I couldn't half do it watching football.
And we've just twatted Everton.
Inevitable. So what are you doing then? Are you kind of, are you paying for it or are you sticking to your guns? It's really, really hard. But, you know, listen, I was joking before, but people will be driven towards,
of course they will,
the other stuff because... Of course you have to. You have to think about yourself and your finances and the current climate. And you are just thinking in this situation, they could have read it a little bit better because people can't go to pubs, people can't go to bars, people are struggling. It just feels...
But even with...
You feel really uneasy about it.
And even with, a limited amount of internet wizardry to proper sound like you have, fella, you can go and subscribe to a channel abroad.
Yeah.
And it'll be cheaper than this option. So it's like... You know, that's mad. That's mad. Like, we're in touch with these people. We all talk to each other now. The world's become a smaller place. So, like, if you're charging someone in Canada this and someone in America that, and then us this, we're going to find out. You can't hide it. It's fucking madness.
It's mad to me as well, Dan, the way all these things come out, which seems to be the way of the world. The government's have at it as well, which is like, it's just suddenly leaked or it's just suddenly in the papers. Like, no one's actually officially sort of, you know, made an announcement as far as I can see. It's just like, oh, it's there it is. It's thrown out there. And I just wonder whether, if they'd have said in the summer, because I know they've been a little bit caught out by people back in stadiums, but they knew that there was going to be issues around capacity all the way through, and they knew that it was going to take a long time to get everyone back in stadiums. I know they thought they'd have some people in, you know, sooner than they're going to, but I just wonder, do you think if they'd have said and they'd have been clear in the summer by to say, do you know what, we want to put every game on this year, that's what we want to do, because we know it's going to be hard for people. You're going to get so many games normal as your package, but for the extra, all these extra games, we want you to pay, I don't know, and it was a flat fee, and it wasn't anywhere near £15 a game. It was near the sort of 5 or 6, but it was like, it's this amount of money for all these extra games, and they'd have said, this is why we need to do it, because I did a little bit of research. I messaged a couple of people, and someone said to me that it costs Sky or BT £500,000 to show a game, and that's obviously with all the razzmatazz and everything and blah blah blah, and that's how much. So there is so eventually, and I know this isn't driven by Sky and BT, it's been driven by the Premier League, but eventually Sky and BT are going to go, well, hang on, you know, we're fronting this cost for nothing here. So I think if they'd have been clear on that and said, look, this is how much it costed, the clubs would have said, we want to be showing you every game because that and that, but and they'd have packaged it all together and said, for all you're getting now, that's staying the same, but if you want literally every game, it's going to, and I don't know what, you know, an extra 20 quid a month or something. Do you think people would have dealt with that better, with a clear message, with a clear why we're doing it, and a more sensible price point?
I think they'd have absorbed it better over time. I mean, on your first point, yeah, I mean, the government's actually accusing another body of backhanded deals.
Unreal, absolute fucking cheeky bastards.
Was probably the highlight of the grimmest day of fucking 2020 so far, to be honest. But yeah, I mean, on your point, look, I think it comes back to the reading of the room thing, because for me, you're selling a watered down product, as we've discussed, and someone's got to sort of bite the bullet somewhere here and say, for us to do this, it would have been sort of the best time to do it would have been when football was at its peak, you know, sort of Liverpool City battling for the title, say 18-19. That would have been the time to go, okay, we can start introducing this now, and then maybe they've felt that they've missed that boat particularly. But I just think that there should have been, it's back to the whole conversations we've had down the years with FSG, where just put someone in the room who knows football on the ground level. You know, just put the equivalent, the Premier League equivalent of a Spirit of Shankly in there and say, well, don't do this because this will happen. And those conversations just don't, even at this level, don't get had. And that common sense just isn't sort of applied to. And whether they're sort of looking at this and saying, well, we know we might lose fans from the game. Like, genuinely, because let's not forget before this, there was a lot of people thinking, I don't know if I can be arsed with this. Even just on the football without fans in stadiums point, there was a lot of people going, I don't fancy this anymore. I don't know if it's something that I can sort of commit myself to or can get up for to an extent. So if they think by getting sort of 10-15% of people paying 15 quid a game, that's better than sort of people switching off and cancelling anyway and the subscription staying the same, then that works better for them. I don't know the logistics, but yeah, I think if they'd have sort of been honest about the situation and said, look, there's all this money tied up in the game. The whole thing around finance in the Premier League is like a pyramid scheme anyway. One thing's paying the other. This money's sort of already paid out to an extent. We have to do something. Here's how it's going to be. But then, you know, when you think about when football came back in May, June, whenever it was, it was all about sort of following Germany's models, following models from abroad. I haven't seen... I might be wrong, but I haven't seen anything from Germany where they're charging 15 quid a game. So again, what is it that the Premier League have seen that they need to do differently? And I think it comes back to, again, the amount of money tied up in this league. And again, the fact that no one's foreseen something like this happening, whether they should or not, that's a different question. But yeah, I think just a bit of honesty, John, would go a long way, to be honest.
Okay, just to finish off on this part, what do we think will happen now? Because, as I say, I haven't seen a thing with how I buy this game or where it's being done or whatever, so it's the announcement isn't there. Do you think there'll be a bit back down? Do you think there'll be a reduction in price? Or do you think, you know, maybe even by the time this is out, we'll have the full details of what channel we need to go with?
I mean, you could argue that's the starting point. And, you know, the 15 quid thing, they probably knew it was too much, but they've started at that. So when it comes down to maybe 12 quid, people go, oh, well, it's not as bad now. Or it comes down to a tenner. But it just, for me, it just still feels like a kick in the balls because, you know, the narrative that was getting spun when fans weren't allowed into stadiums, which is still the case, obviously, was that, you know, it isn't the same game. And the governing bodies were saying, we need the fans back. The players were saying, we need the fans back. The media were saying, we need the fans back. It's not the same. So to then have this thrust upon you where it's like, well, you've got to pay this now if you want to watch these teams. And I don't think it'll happen because I think people will go and find their own ways of doing it. But I think it's almost a starting point, John, where they'll say one price and then they'll come down to maybe 12, 10 quid over the coming weeks.
Do you agree with that?
I think they'll just do it now. I think they're going to do it. I mean, you know, that Liverpool game, Sky Sports box office, they're already saying that's where it is. That's where you go and get it. So I think it's happening. But like I said before, I'd like to see people stay away from it because I think it sets a dangerous precedent. I think it's wrong. I think it's the wrong time to do it. If there is a sort of a nice spin-off to it, this might just be me being romantic, but look, I liked the tweet. Some Manc lad put up on Twitter, I just found it now, he said, Premier League clubs are demanding $14.95 to watch them on pay-per-view. He said, the other night I went to watch Trafford FC. Ticket, £8, pies, peas and gravy, £2.85, a pint, £3.40, and I go on the first goal scorer raffle, £1, total £15.25, and obviously actually got to stand by a pitch and watch some football. And look, you know, you can't even do that in certain parts of Merseyside right now, although I did see some pictures from Marine the other day and I was fuming that I'd missed out on that one. But you know, like, footy isn't just about watching from in front of a screen, and you know, I get that's the way that a lot of people around the world will watch Liverpool and watch the Premier League. I totally get that, but I think, you know, we're going to come on now to talk about something else, which is about football isn't just about the Premier League. It's about the pyramid. It's about the game at every level. It's about the community. It's about socialising, seeing your friends and all that kind of stuff. And so, yeah, maybe if it's 15 quid, maybe more people like Danny start to think, well, I'll go and watch a local side. I'll get more for me 15 quid.
Yeah, I did notice as well, there's a Newcastle fan site who's encouraging people to donate the money to a food bank as well, which isn't a bad shout indeed. But you know, they have to watch Newcastle, don't they? So it's an easier sell. Okay, we'll we'll move on from there. We are going to come back and talk about Project Big Picture, as I've mentioned. But before all that, I spoke about a week or so now, but we wanted to put it in this because we thought it'd be a quiet week, lol. I spoke to Matt Parrish from the LFC Foundation, because it is worth remembering. We do criticise decisions and certain individuals at Liverpool Football Club, but there's a lot of good people working there as well, and Matt is very much one of them. Matt is from the LFC Foundation, and he wants to say thank you. Basically, he wants to say thank you to our listeners and also the supporters widely for how they've been supported recently. So here is me talking to Matt Parrish from the LFC Foundation. And it is John Gibbons for the Anfield. I'm delighted to be joined over Zoom by Matt Parrish from LFC Foundation. Matt, welcome back.
Thanks, John. Good to be here.
Yeah, well, it's nice. It's nice to ever do a follow-up story on some good news. We had you back on early July, Matt's talking about the foundation and talking specifically about the Legends game, which you unfortunately had to cancel, which wasn't just a shame for all the people who were looking forward to going to the game, of course, but also as a fundraiser, it's massive for you guys, isn't it? It's huge in terms of pulling in the money that allows you to do all the great stuff you do.
Yeah, I mean, I think the last few years we've been fortunate. I think we've had four sellout games now, and they've raised this in and around £1 million per game, which is brilliant. And what we've done in the last couple of years, we've sort of started to designate that a bit more. So we've gone out beforehand saying, look, assuming we sell out, we're going to spend a proportion of the money on this particular project. Or an example has been the Cash for Kids program with Radio City. Obviously, the game getting cancelled, so it's a blow there in terms of that fundraising. But we decided to, we came up with the idea of asking fans to still get involved, and would they still be interested in fundraising? But we were very conscious of, you know, with what everyone's going through at the moment, people might need a few pounds back in their own pockets. So we offered a chance for fans to have a refund for that game in full or part, or to donate full or part of that money back to us. And fortunately, quite a few have decided to donate to us.
Yeah, it's £250,000, I believe, that you've raised, which must sort of, I don't know, must really touch you, humble you, that people...
Sorry, John, as I say, you took the words out of my mouth. It's humbling, really. I think especially we appreciate, you know, what the situation everyone's in, but it's actually going to be, I think it's going to be 260, maybe just over, from that game. We've also had almost 50K from members of Ballroom and Exec Lounge. One was a couple from the Exec Lounge who donated 25K. And I think the interesting thing for us, John, we've designated the money. So we went out and said, look, all the money we raise is going to be spent on either food poverty, mental health support work, or employment support work. The food poverty element will obviously be in partnership with North Liverpool Food Banks through St Andrews Network and Fan Supporting Food Banks. The club have got a long-standing brilliant partnership there with an unbelievable work the guys do, and it specifically about helping them to set up community pantries, which is a sort of a bit more of a sustainable, longer term sustainable project rather than food crisis is unfortunately, you know, a real issue. But the community pantries perhaps give people the opportunity of a bit more, sort of, I suppose, dignity of choice, if that's the right term, and more of a supermarket type experience. So I think that's hopefully resonated with fans. It certainly resonated with some of the other donations we've had. But to be able to, I think, telling that story and emphasising that it was going to support in those three areas, which were three areas where we thought we could help most in the next, you know, 6-12 months, it seems to have really resonated with the fans. And it is humbling that they've done that. And it's, I suppose, it's to reassure fans that that money will be used across Liverpool City region to support in those areas.
Yeah, and as you say, the areas that the foundation have always looked to support in, but now more than ever, unfortunately, is going to be necessary. I mean, all those things that you've talked about, you know, have been issues in Liverpool for a long time, and not just Liverpool, sort of, you know, wider than that, but more so than ever, food poverty, unfortunately, will be an issue. More so than ever, people are finding it difficult to find work. And then obviously, everything going on at the moment, all that and more is causing strain on mental health and people kind of struggling with how they deal with the world, if you like.
Yeah, and all of those things are connected, John, aren't they? And I think that, as you say, that the Red Neighbours team at the club has had that real target focus on food poverty in North Liverpool and also around Kirby with the new training ground. But I think the wider foundation work in terms of work with young people that are unemployed, our unemployment support work is a bit wider now, looking at perhaps certainly focusing on young people, but also looking to support anyone really that may have lost a job, been made redundant, and can we help them find new skills and upskill. From a mental health perspective, someone said the other day that every young person that's lived through this is going to have, has had an ACE, has had an adverse childhood experience. It's impacted on all young people in a lot of ways, and there's lots of young people that have had their resilience tested. And I think if we can try and offer support and signposting in that space, but what I think has been a positive of this from our perspective, almost, I don't know if selfish is the right word, but it's enabled us to link in and work more closely with other groups that we've wanted to work with for a long time. So we've announced that we're working alongside Spirit Shankly and Spine Cop around fans talking about their own mental health, not just men, but, you know, adult males, adults generally. That it's a message that we've all heard before, but it's okay not to be okay, but supporting fans to reach out, to look out for each other, but to about signposting information where they can go if they have got concerns. But we will be actually running physical programs that if people want to come to and get support and guidance, that and then they can. But I think it shows, I mean, that someone said to me the other day, it's an interesting thing, the Marcus Rashford thing is an interesting, the fact that Marcus is, you know, a young man who's using his platform to raise what's such a big area of need. I know he's got a personal connection to it, having had to rely on free school meals and food banks when he was growing up. I think he might be the first, perhaps he'll be the first Man United player to run it at Anfield when fans are back in stadiums and getting stand innovation. I think he's going to get that at a lot of stadiums around the country. But what he's doing is he's highlighting something that we all know is an issue that wasn't there, but is. And like I said, this the work that the North Liverpool Food Bank, Fan Supporting Food Bank, anyone in that space does is unbelievable. But for us and for the fans to be able to support that work in and around Anfield is brilliant.
Yeah, you mentioned those partnerships, and I think it's worth sort of highlighting that, Matt, because obviously, you know, for a while people have wanted Liverpool to lead in terms of community stuff, and there's been, you know, the idea of, obviously, you know, we all love our football club, we all love it being there, but there was a desire, I think, amongst fans for Liverpool to take the lead, I guess, in the area in terms of leading to improvements, and these partnerships, I would guess, sort of help make that happen, really. You're saying that, well, Liverpool haven't necessarily got all the answers, but what you do have is willing, what you do have is the ability to obviously to raise money, and with support of people who are on the ground doing great things, then I guess together we can all make a difference.
Yeah, and I think that's key. I think I've been fortunate enough to sort of work in this sector for, well, a long time, 20 odd years. obviously only at Liverpool for the last 18-19 months, but what I think is key at any club is that a football club is born from its local community, isn't it? Without and fans and supporters in the local community are the lifeblood of those clubs, and I think we have a responsibility to give back, but it only works if we work in partnership. We can't do it all. It's a partnership is about we all bring our best elements to that partnership. That's what I try and tell my wife all the time. She doesn't. But the point being is that if you think about mental health, we are in no way suggesting that we are, nor do we want to be experts in mental health. But I think what we can do is we can raise awareness, we can draw in partners, we can raise funds, and we can signpost. We can do what we're good at. We can engage. We can. For me, a person is more likely to come to a session if it's run, you know, it's facilitated by one of our staff in a Liverpool tracksuit than they might be to set foot in a clinical setting. But if we then feel that more clinical support is needed, we can signpost. We might be able to have more clinical support working alongside partners that's what they do. That's when it works. I think if we try to say we could do everything end to end, then it won't work. And again, it's what St Andrew's Network and what Fan Supporting Food Banks movement is raised awareness. But what St Andrew's do is amazing. We don't need to try and do that. Where can we help? Well, we can hopefully help to generate funds that allow them to do what they do.
Yeah, no, 100%. So thanks a lot, obviously, to Matt for coming on. And if you were someone who donated and you did so off the back of what you heard off the Anfield app, hopefully now you've heard all the fantastic places that will be getting support from that money that you donated and that you allowed the foundation to keep. So nice one to you. If you want to see more about what the foundation are doing, they are really active on Twitter. It's at LFC Foundation, which is really simple. And they're showing all the time the things that they are doing and obviously ways that you can support them if you do wish to. So do check them out on there. But in the meantime, Matt, nice to see you. And hopefully lots more exciting announcements and worthy announcements sort of over the next few months and years. Okay, we're back in the room. I'm still with Dan Morgan by Gareth Roberts and my ear man. We're just laughing. Dan Morgan's struggling with his mic there. I'll just leave him to it.
It's on video as well, this, you know, Dan.
You can't keep it up.
Get in.
I'll tell you what. Absolutely awful. Okay, we're serious football chat. We're going to talk about Project Big Picture. If you haven't seen it yet, I'm sure you have. But I'll just do a little summary of what's being proposed. As I said at the top, apparently this is being led by Liverpool and Manchester United, but with 3 years of discussion, although seemingly not to everyone's knowledge that those 3 years of discussion were going on, but certainly to Vic Parry's, who's been very vocal in his support of what it might mean for the EFL clubs. So what does it mean? In a bit of a nutshell, what is being proposed, and this is apparently just something that's being put out there, not necessarily a finalised agreement, but it is an 18-team Premier League, no League Cup or Community Shield, a playoff for the third place relegation between the team who comes third bottom in the Premier League and I think third, fourth and fifth in the Championship. A £250 million rescue fund for the EFL related to COVID, a scrap of parachute payments, also a 25% of TV money from the Premier League shared amongst the EFL clubs, another £100 million to the FA. And then here's the bit that's maybe slightly more controversial, special voting rights for nine clubs, which includes what are now described as the traditional Big Six, plus a few more based on Premier League years in it, and lots of other interesting things, which I haven't seen as much focus on, but other interesting things around away fans, around safe standing, and also stadium investments as well. So we'll start with you, Gareth. What did you make of it, and what have you made of sort of the discussion around it since?
I mean, there's a lot there, isn't there, as you just read out, and I think, you know, my feelings about it to sum up in one way, would just be mixed, because, you know, some of it I'm behind, and, you know, obviously in the 10 years we've been doing this, we've been talking about all that time about more money should drip down, more money should go to the rest of football, it shouldn't just be about the big clubs. You know, this goes some way to addressing that, and I think the idea of more money from TV deals going further down the pyramid is a good idea. I think the parachute payments being scrapped is a good idea. Various aspects of it I think are good ideas, but there's a few things that really sort of rub me up the wrong way. One is the timing of it. It looks opportunistic. It looks like a power grab, a land grab, whatever you want to call it. And also as well, just from a pure, you know, sort of almost like a PR perspective, I guess, I'm not entirely comfortable with the idea that Liverpool's owners are essentially jumping into bed with the Glazers, because what do they know about football and what have they done that's good for football? All they've done is aggressively take over a football club and burn off a load of money that, you know, ultimately has helped Liverpool, I guess, because Man United could have spent even more money than they have done. But, you know, when we're being serious, they have not been great for that club. And then to be saying, you know, here's a fella, you know, Joel Glazer or whatever you want, telling us how we should run the game in our country. Not for me. And a bit like the sort of, you know, the ticket debate there, it's a bit mad how it's come out as well. You know, like, why now and why like this? It feels very strong arm. It feels very like, this is what we're doing. And, you know, some of the grimmest bits for me, some of the ugliest bits for me are the idea, like, well, this is the idea. And if it doesn't get voted through, you know, there's a big hint there of, well, we'll just walk away and do something else. We might join the EFL. And, you know, like, you know, when that was put to Parry several times by several media organisations over the weekend, he's not denied that. You know, he's leaving it purposely on the table, it looks like. So I find all that grim, to be honest with you. It goes back to me to when Ian Ayre was talking about Bolton, saying no one wants to watch Bolton abroad, but they do want to watch Liverpool. You know, so this attitude has been there for a good decade now from Liverpool, from Man United, from the, I should say, the owners or the hierarchy around those clubs rather than the actual club. One thing I object to is the idea that, you know, something that Liverpool might be doing here is somehow in any way associated with me. It's not. They never asked me. They never asked my opinion. They haven't asked fans' opinion again. And some of the stuff that's bolted on that you mentioned, John, kind of feels like just sort of throwing us a bit of toffee to make it sound sweet. So, you know, oh, £20 tickets for away games, that sounds good. Oh, they're going to look at safe standing. Well, that's something we've campaigned for. That sounds good. And it you know, there's loads of bits of toffee. Oh, yeah, we'll spend this money on the women's game. You know, we'll give £100 million to the FA. You know, it's ended up that, you know, the tail's wagging the dog, because the FA used to run football, and now you know what this says is the FA have become irrelevant, and here's a bit of dough for you, but we're going to go over here and do this. And, you know, loads of it, you know, it's just going to make it less competitive for me. Essentially, that would be my fear. So if you've got clubs that can basically box themselves off, that can sell the TV rights themselves, well, we all know if you're going to, you know, there's something right in what Ian Ayre said, in that, of course, there's more interest in Liverpool around the world than there is Bolton, but don't you want the league to be competitive, though? Because if Liverpool just rake in more, and six clubs rake in more and more, and you know, you're just guaranteeing your spot and you're putting a big fence around it, that for me is not then a true competition, and it's not the spirit of the competition. And, you know, I love the football pyramid, as I've already said just before and many times on this show. You know, I love the idea that there are lots of little football clubs around the country that, you know, aren't necessarily, you know, football is a business, that's been rammed down our throats since 1992. For loads of clubs, it isn't, though. For loads of clubs, it's just a community thing. It's not run to make loads and loads of money. It's run for the love of football. And, you know, this plan, to me, doesn't look like it's run for it doesn't look like it comes from a place where it's the love of football. We're seeing stuff about, oh yeah, John Henry and the Glazers, you know, they really like the pyramids in England and all this. Come out and say it then yourself. You know, where are you? Put yourself in front of a camera and talk about it. Like, why is Rick Parry the fella under the bus here? I mean, in terms of what it's potentially doing to the clubs that were down the leagues, obviously that bit is really good, and that bit needs to happen, and something needs to happen. So I would say that aspect of it is quite good, in that it started the debate, it's put it in the public domain, it's probably twisting some arms up backs now, and maybe we get somewhere. But as it stands, the detail that we have, I mean, I don't think that's going to be agreed anyway. We're already adding up to eight clubs and not into the idea, and as it stands, you need 14 to get a proposal through.
Ian?
Yeah, I mean, Robbo's covered loads there, and I think I agree with most of it, to be honest, if not all of it. I think, you know, I agree, you're not going to get it through, because I think the voting thing where, you know, nine clubs have essentially got power, but really it's six, and I don't think anyone wants to see that, to be honest. You know, Rick Parry's line about, you know, Liverpool and Man United showing interest in the pyramid, I mean, it's absolute nonsense. It's just nonsense. Is it they care? I mean, they've got to throw a bit of toffee and pretend, but they don't care. It's about looking after your own interests, and I get that to some extent. But let's not make out that they care about what's going on below them.
Listen, I've heard John Henry goes to Prescott Cables every time he's over. Yeah,
that's a pipe with Robbo. But that's just nonsense. And I'd rather them come out and just be a little bit more honest and try and spin it in a way that gets people on board by trying to con them a little bit. Not that anyone would fall for that. I mean, listen, it is opportunistic, and it's a little bit preying on the weak to some extent, because they know there's a desperation, because clubs are on the verge, and you know, they could go out of business. So all of a sudden you start dangling carrots, you know, 250 million quid.
I mean, as bribes go, it's a pretty good one. You're gonna
jump on it. Listen, it's a plan with flaws. Now, you might say a plan with flaws is better than having no plan at all. And I think there has to be some kind of reset. It's been 28 years since, you know, the Premier League started. So you can definitely argue a case of something needs to happen. Robbo touched on some of the good stuff. You know, all of a sudden, grassroots getting more money, of course, big tick. Yeah, clubs down the pyramid get more money, big tick. But the voting thing doesn't sit well. You know, some people like the Leicester story where they go and win the league. You can kiss goodbye to that ever happening again. You know, that's not going to happen because, as Robert alluded to, it's almost about creating a closed shop, and you're going to have clubs there that just continue to thrive. And listen, you can look at this through the prism and through the eyes of your own football club and say, sound, listen, I want us to be better. I want us to always be in the top six. I want us to always be fighting for the honours. Yes, I get that, but there's also something around the fairness. And one of the best things about the game for me is that unpredictability of it sometimes, where someone can just come out of nowhere and win the league, or you know, you want it to be sometimes about other teams forcing their way in. It just creates interest. You know, I think one of the things in there as well is that they've got the power to veto anyone else coming in and taking over a football club. That doesn't sit right. You want competition. You want someone to be able to come in and create a bit of a dream for fans, where they buy the club and maybe they do it the right way, but they invest and they give them a bit of money. That's competition. That's fair. That's what should happen. So, yes, there's lots in there that I like, and I think there's discussion points. And yeah, listen, fans going in for cheaper, of course, we can all get on board with that. But there's some stuff in there that doesn't sit well. It won't sit well. I don't think it'll get through. But it's a starting point. And as David Conn said in The Guardian, you know, it's about getting around the table and looking at the bits that are good and working from there. And yet, some of it can be swept under the table as nonsense. But there is some good stuff in there, and you can't forget that.
Dan?
Well... just adjusting the mic accordingly, sorry John. Look, what the guys have said is absolutely spot on in that sense. I mean, just to play devil's advocate a little bit, I mean, I'm completely in agreement that it is sort of all the taglines of power grabbing and stuff like that. Let's not act like this has been on a whim from FSG. They've had this in mind for a good few years, I think.
Draft 18 apparently. Well, of the documents.
Yeah, the timing of its release is probably maybe opportunistic, but you know, this has been their vision, I think, for the Premier League, going back to sort of, you know, you remember that picture of all the owners having dinner around the table, and it just felt like those kind of discussions were sort of being had then. And again, to play devil's advocate, it's back to the John Henry quote from a couple of years back, where he was talking about how Liverpool are the equivalent of a Showtime boxer, you know, a heavyweight boxer, top of the bill, and the money that they are basically getting is being equally distributed. And in his opinion, that wasn't right. That Liverpool should have more of that pie, if you like. For us as football fans, that doesn't sit right, because we do want things to be as equal as possible. And you sort of wonder where their version of sort of this being fair and equal comes into it. I wonder sort of, you know, we touched on Man United. I wonder if they're thinking, well, your equivalent here is having the Mansours and Abramoviches of the world owning football clubs who don't want to share anything between the leagues. You know, they don't want any kind of equilibrium. That basically means that more teams get a say, autonomy or whatever. You know, they just want their clubs to have the most power, and everyone else can basically sit behind them. But the alternative isn't to sort of say, well, the top six get priority, and the top six therefore is basically set in terms of who finishes in those positions each year, because that, you know, that again is, it becomes very quickly, you know, a league of six and then a second league of 14, or you know, 12 if it's going to go to 18 teams. So that's one thing that stood out. And then there's the other things, like logistically, you know, people have mentioned super clubs is Super Leagues again. I don't think that's what they're aiming for with that. I think what you probably end up with is two sets of fixtures which run parallel in terms of domestic league and a European league, and I think that's probably something that FSG and maybe the Glazers would think as an ideal scenario, in that, you know, you get rid of the League Cup and the Shield, for example, but then you get your more lucrative pre-season tours, and then you get a Champions League that basically runs as a second league as well as the Premier League. And again, where's the players' protection in all that? You know, Liverpool have got a manager who constantly bangs the drum about players being looked after and not being flogged as commodities. This deal on the face of it tells you one thing, but when you look into it, it says, well, you might actually just be flogging them more and sending them around the world more and stuff like that. So on the face of it, there's all these sweeteners, but like everything with stuff like this, they can be reneged on the minute it gets passed through. So I'm with the lads, I don't think it will. I think if you're someone like Fulham, for example, you're looking at that going, well, why on earth would we vote for that? Where does that benefit us? So yeah, I think it's there to be shot down and probably will do.
What's interesting though, Dan, is that, and I'll stick with you for a second, is obviously the Premier League clubs towards the bottom end, shall we say, all seem to be against it. But you go further down and there's a lot of chairmen speaking out in favour of it. I noticed the owner of Derby County, saying that, you know, for him there's more good in there than bad, and that they probably support it. That the Forest Green chairman has done a couple of interviews saying that it's great for us. And you can understand that, can't you? Apparently it'll be worth about £8 million each for clubs in the Football League. And if I'm Forest Green, I'm thinking, well, all what you're saying is right about, well, they don't want anyone else to win the Premier League, but we're not fucking winning the Premier League anyway. So do you know what I mean? In terms of, you know, making sure that we have a future, making sure we have a football club, you understand why some of these, you know, clubs further down the pyramid, Vic Paddy's saying a lot of them are supportive, you know, privately, and you can see why.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I get that. And again, coming into it, sort of the parachute payments point is again, can be seen as a force of good, because that's an issue that needs addressing. And again, it's back to the thing of there's no fit and proper body that is sorting this out.
Yeah.
So here's us trying to do it for you. And you can get them why lower league clubs will say, well, at least they're having a go.
Yeah.
You know, and we'll take them on the word that if this gets passed through, they'll give us what they're saying. I think where it then becomes a bit tricky is that, again, you know, the line has to stop somewhere. And if that line is sort of 10th in the Premier League, then that product, that dream, if you like, it just becomes a little bit too formatted for me. And it becomes, I don't know, it sort of becomes a case that is already set in stone, and the autonomy there is a rule that can't be broken, and no one can ever sort of even dream of getting near it. And we're, you know, you might be right, John. You might be that there are teams who are sort of mid-championship who go, we're not asked about that. You know, if we get in the Premier League, the aim is to finish 16th, 15th, or whatever, how many ties they'll be in there, I don't know. So sort of, if there was a way in which they could have framed it that would have made it just sound a little bit softer in terms of when it gets to the top, then I think that they might have had some legs in it. But I think all, you know, whatever they would have proposed, the FA's got to be sitting there thinking, A, we've got a massive amount of damage prior here, even more so than usual. But B, you know, there's no way in which we can sort of seem to be on board with this, because these are basically telling us that they'll do our job for us. Because if we agree to it, then, you know, or if this has an overwhelming majority in favour, then, you know, the question which should have been asked a long time ago and doesn't get asked, what's the point of the FA, will then come to the fore, I guess.
I mean, well, that's come to the fore anyway, though, hasn't it, Gareth? Yeah. And that's, you know, we've been aware of that, you know, as football fans for a while now. And I think whatever happens, this is a shame on the FA and the Premier League, because, you know, Vic Paddy's been on TV a lot, as you said, and I've not agreed with everything he said, far from it. But where I think it's hard to argue, he says, well, this is the best proposal that's come out on reforming football of the last 25 years.
Yeah.
And however much you like it, that's true, isn't it? And that is depressing, actually, and it's shame on the Premier League and the FA that this is the best that anyone's come up with.
It's the only thing on the table, isn't it, as things stand? And, you know, look, you can, loads of people are throwing Paddy under the bus, and I fully understand why, but, you know, I guess if you had him in the studio, maybe from his perspective, he'd say, well, look, you know, I'm working for the EFL, and my job is to protect the EFL, and, you know, as things currently stand, you know, 92% of the Premier League's dough stays in the Premier League. This is saying 25% would start to go down the chain, and, you know, you mentioned that what it would work out at. Well, a piece in The Athletic said it would be worth £15 million per championship club, £3.5 million per League One club, and £2.3 million per League Two club per season, and that's massive. You know, 2.3 million quid at League Two levels, loads of money, yeah. Loads of money. And that's why, as you say, you know, there's plenty of chairmen out there who are coming on saying, yeah, listen, this right now looks really attractive, because, you know, I think it was the Leighton Orient fella who was like, you know, in 5 to 6 weeks, like you could see teams going bust. That's how desperate the situation is. But that's where you come back to what I said before about it feeling a bit opportunistic and a bit grim, because yes, it's a good idea, and yes, we'd like to see that money drip down, but to do it in this way where you're saying, but only if we get all this power and only if we get to control things. And I, you know, the predictability thing, I think, is a problem. I mean, you know, you go back to when Ian Ayre was saying, he was talking then about Barcelona and Real Madrid and saying, well, we can't really compete with them because they negotiate their own TV deals. But who thinks the Spanish league's great? Because I see a lot of people who say, well, it's not that competitive. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's a lot of games where, you know, full well that, you know, whoever are going to get tonked 5-6 by Barca or by Real Madrid. And like, we're not quite at that stage in England yet. But equally, though, I think in the last four seasons, you know, hardly any of this big six that they've arbitrarily decided is a big six or big nine, whatever. You know, it's always them in Europe. It's always them teams in Europe. You know, and even the likes of Everton and Southampton, like European campaigns have been rare for them. And, you know, all of it, there's loads of problems with it. And perhaps they knew that, and perhaps this is part of the plan. Perhaps they put it like, you know, ridiculously over to one side, knowing that they'd have to meet somewhere in the middle. And perhaps we see that over the next few days when there's meetings and things like that. But, you know, again, I've seen a thing where, you know, when you're talking about the teams that it should be, you know, if you talk, tradition has been mentioned and clubs that are traditionally up there. Well, most top six finishes in English top flight history, Liverpool are top, then Arsenal, then Man United, then it's Villa, then it's Everton, then it's Tottenham. Chelsea and Man City aren't in it because they're new money, you know what I mean? And it's like, well, so you could rightly say if you're Villa, well, why are they getting a seat at the table and why don't we? And there's loads of problems with it. And there's loads of protectionism, and you know, even the thing about they want to alter the distribution money in the Premier League, but it's going to be almost based on like a 4-year average. Even that's slightly grim, because it's almost saying, so you can afford to be shit, you can afford to like make a mistake with your manager or have loads of injuries and drop down loads of places, but it won't really matter because we've protected you. And equally, if you're coming in new and you've managed to force your way into the Premier League, it's unlikely you're going to get near to the top of the rungs and really, you know, threaten these clubs. And again, bit grim, you know, you mentioned, like, just the romance, it's tugging away at the romance for me. You know, Tranmere nearly got in the Premier League in my lifetime, and I would have loved to have seen that. And Tranmere wouldn't all of a sudden have got 50,000 a week. They literally can't fit that many in the ground. But the idea of a romantic football story where a club like Tranmere nearly got into the top flight was brilliant. Then they've gone all the way back down, obviously, into non-league, which is mad. But I just think it's meaning those stories are less likely to happen. You know, I think it was it Sunderland got promoted 1 year? And then we're like right at the top, weren't they? And, you know, scoring shitloads of goals, bloodying some noses. And it was a great story. You know, it was a great football story. Okay, I'm a Liverpool fan. But I don't think it's just be like, well, I just want Liverpool to win at all costs and fuck everyone else.
Yeah, again, I agree with loads. I think it was interesting that Palios actually didn't want it.
He was great.
He didn't want it, which goes against the grain maybe of some of the other kind of League Two, League One clubs. I think, no, there's got to be a change in the distribution of the money to some of those clubs, because I think it's £90 million, the TV deal for the 72 clubs, but the majority of that's swallowed up by the Championship. So it doesn't give those guys a great deal in terms of League One and League Two. And as we said before, you know, it is opportunistic because some of those clubs are on the cusp now, and they're desperate for money. So the chances are they might agree to virtually anything because it keeps them going. I think Palios's point was, well, this might be a short-term fix, but what happens long-term? You know what I mean? That's the worry, you know, what happens to us long-term? We don't quite know that because it feels very short-termism. But as I say, there's lots in there, I think, to get your teeth around and think, yes, there's good stuff in there. But as I say before, you know, there's one or two bits that just doesn't sit well, and we've touched on those in terms of the romantic side of it. You know, you want to keep that in the game. You absolutely want to keep that in the game. And yes, sometimes it may mean your team don't win. That's football. That's what happens sometimes. I don't want to lose any of that.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, we're going to leave it there, well, more or less. I just want to finish on a little bit of a plea, really, and I haven't written anything down. I'm just going to sort of speak from the heart, so if it's a bit of a mess, I apologise. But everyone who's listening to this obviously supports Liverpool Football Club, and I'd like to ask you to support Liverpool as a city as much as you can as well in these times that are going to be very, very difficult for those of us who are living there. So if you do live in Liverpool and listening to this, which I know lots of you do, I'd encourage you as much as possible to shop locally over the next sort of few months. If you're not quite sure how to do that, and you need a bit of a hand, there's a website called Lids, which is a really good place to start, which is all local produce that is delivered right to your door, and you can get a bit of everything and anything on there. It's a bit of a one-stop shop of local providers. The Guide Liverpool have got a brilliant site as well of lots of local companies and independent companies who are still open and need your support and will want your support. So that's for people who live there. If you live a little bit further afield, I would ask you when is safe and when you feel safe to come and visit us, if you can. So if you normally come for the football, obviously you can't do that at the moment. You know, I know that rate's very high at the moment in terms of Corona in Liverpool, but when it is safe to do so and when importantly you feel safe to do so, do come and see us. The hotels will be made up, and the hospitality will be delighted, restaurants, I'm thinking cafes, things like that. We'd love to see you. You can see the Premier League trophy at Anfield at the moment as well. So what a reason to come up. And there's a new exhibition, I gather, in the museum, which includes the Anfield Wrap, which someone said they saw the last few days. So come up and see us. Do come up and support us whenever it is you can. In terms of further afield, if you can't get to Liverpool, if you live in Timbuktu or whatever, the Anfield Wrap are going to be producing a list of local charities and local businesses that you can support, and we're going to be putting that out on social media and maybe via email as well. This is all a little bit sort of, you know, thrown together sort of today. So, but there's obviously charities like the food banks that we are supporting all the time, and also we're going to try and get a list of local businesses who deliver further afield as well. So if you are a local business and you want us to champion you, get in touch, and we will obviously do that. We're proud of our city, and it's a beautiful city, and it will stay a beautiful city, but we don't want to live in a museum. We want to live somewhere that's vibrant, we want to live somewhere that's exciting, and we want to live somewhere that's forward thinking and not backward thinking. That's in danger at the moment, genuine danger, but with your help it'll be less so. So thank you very much, and there'll be much more of this from the Anfield Wrap over the next few weeks.